about my institute. So Symbiosis Institute of Technology is located in Pune, and I'm sure Pune is the second largest hub for industry. So we are surrounded by a huge number of industries, and that's a good advantage our engineering college gets. The Symbiosis Institute of Technology is in constituent of Symbiosis International University, which is accredited by NAC two times by A grade. Also, it's having NIRF ranking of 43. So that shows, the umbrella university is really a very state of the art and I would say powerful university, because, we are on the shoulder of the giant sitting at Symbiosis Institute of Technology. If you see the campus, last year we got MHRD Best Campus Award in the entire country. Why I'm telling this, because, unfortunately you could not travel here, but our campus is like a resort where you can get a huge lake, peacocks, all kinds of birds, and it's on the hilltop, right? So that shows, everything about the campus, because MHRD has selected us as the best campus. If I tell about Institute of Technology, we have undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD program. Undergraduate programs are in basic disciplines like mechanical, civil, electronics, computer, and IT. But the curriculum is really very holistic. Even before AICTS declared the model curriculum, whereby a lot of humanities courses and other courses to be added, our curriculum is already state of the art, having some of the unique features. If I tell you that critical thinking is a compulsory course, creative thinking, organizational behavior, then ethics, project-based learning, all of the courses are compulsory. Project-based learning starts from semester one, where we have a very unique tinker lab, which is kind of a todo foro jodo, where the first year students open up bike, freeze, car, and then play around with the hardware. So these are some of the unique features of our curriculum, which are there are several, but I'm just cutting it short. And we do have a unique feature like flexi courses, where 10% of the credits, the subjects are not decided on fly. When the students come in second year, third year, if there is a, let's say, industry 4.0 or 5.0 or AI is something coming new, then we can introduce on fly without taking any approval from any of the bodies, right? It is in the dean's power. So I can understand that those faculty members, those who are from traditional universities or otherwise, sometimes find it difficult to update the syllabus. But here, the power lies with the director or dean. Okay, I can decide if what is to be taught in next semester, which is as good as 10% of the credits. So I would say around 5 to 6 courses, right? So these are some of the unique features. And one more unique feature is our university is, by name itself is Symbiosis International University. We have a large number of tie-ups with international organizations and universities. And we have a very flexi credit transfer program for our students. Students can go abroad in any semester after third semester. It's not only final semester, right? And we do the customized credit mapping for the students. We do have a social internship is a compulsory course, whereby there's a 4-credit course. Student needs to go to villages, understand the problems of villages, and solve using engineering way. So I'm sure that will create a good mindset for the students as well. So I can go on telling about large number of such activities, because it's my own institute. But let me tell you that all these have been possible because of very enthusiastic pool of faculty members I have, and large number of research activities are also going on in the institute. We have a center of excellence in artificial intelligence, in nanotechnology, in medical image analysis, and waste management as well, right? So these are some of the research centers where our students can also do the internship, and a large number of patents and publications have been filed by our faculty members as well. And of course, because as I mentioned, it's a hub, industry hub, the placement is not an issue at all, and a lot of multinational companies come to the placement for our students as well. So these are some of the points apart from, there's one more point which I should not forget. Before 2 years, we have established an incubator, which is located at the third floor of our building only. Which is sponsored by Department of Science and Technology, where already there are 25 startups we are nurturing. I happen to be CEO of that center as well right now. So if you know your students are interested, we'll be very much happy to enroll them. And all the facilities are free because you know we have been given a hefty grant from central government for that. Even our students, those who are in the engineering, they are also starting their own company while they are studying. And there's a great example whereby a second year computer engineering students got 2 crore rupees funding because he started his own company. He's a second year student of our own institute, right? So there are several such examples. I'll not take much time, and I really congratulate all of you and Dr. Sonavane and head of the department for creating such a wonderful, you know, program. And of course, we should not forget the pain taken by AICTE, our umbrella body, which I'm sure everyone will join for the inauguration at 11 o'clock. And that's a great help, a mentorship from AICTE, because we consider AICTE as a controlling body. But today we see that they are mentoring the faculty member, right? So with that, congratulations and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving a brief about our university. I will take 2 more minutes to talk about our department. Unfortunately, Dr. Karnal Pandey have a weak internet connection, so he requested me to just go ahead. So in our department, basically, we almost have a doctorate faculty, or those who are having, they are about to complete their PhD. And mechanical engineering department is very strong in terms of, say, research activity and publications. Particularly, we have a different domains in our institute. Particularly, we have a very strong manufacturing. Then we do have a very strong, say, thermal, as well as we also do have a very strong in design. Particularly, so we worked as a particular team. We do interact with each other. I will not give the details of our publication and all those things, but we have a latest facility called as e-mobility lab. Particularly, we have been developed. Also, we have a state-of-art 3D printing facilities. We do have a state-of-art 3D printer with us. Then, apart from that, as Director Sir have already told you about the excellence centers, so we are constantly exchanging our research ideas and all those things with them. Apart from that, we will also have a small research lab where one of the, say, computational fluid dynamics is also one of the research lab. A lot of faculties have, fundings from various national international agencies. So I'm giving this brief because you are most welcome to interact with us. We can have great collaborations, and thank you very much. So I think we'll stop here with our formally inaugural program. Thank you, Dr. Ketan Kotija, sir, Dr. Nitin, sir, for your presence. Sir, thank you very much. So we'll start with our guest session. So let me introduce our today's expert. Good morning, Dr. Shevadkar, sir.
Good morning, all of you.
Okay. So we know that CFD is very essential in our day-to-day industrial as well as in academics as well. And although we are saying that advances in computational fluid dynamics, however, we cannot leave the basics of CFD. So we must start from the basics. So Dr. Shevadkar is going to brief us on the basics of computational fluid dynamics, how we can go ahead with our basic equations, how they can be implemented to a small cases, and then how we can take those cases to a higher level, particularly. So I'll just take 1 more minute to introduce Dr. Shevadkar, sir. Dr. Shevadkar, sir, is my senior. In fact, he has done a PhD from IIT Bombay. Sir has a lot of contribution as far as research is concerned. He has few papers, in fact, many papers in reputed journals. You can go to the Google Scholar and have his all the research curriculum there. He also won the Best PhD Award during his PhD time. Best PhD student, I think. And sir is already working in COEP Pune, College of Engineering Pune. Then he recently shifted to the College of Engineering Avsari. He has a vast experience in teaching, particularly. He also got a Best Teacher Award during his video. So his CV is very brief. Okay, so I just give you thought of, he has very vast knowledge, starting from basics to the, say, particularly. So, sir, thank you for accepting our invitation. And
yeah, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure.
Yes, sir. So I will just let you know ki how to just particularly share the screen. So I'll stop my sharing. Yeah. So, sir, can you able to share the screen? Just let me know.
Yeah, it is there.
So, sir, please share the screen so that we can all see. Meanwhile,
yeah,
I need to
go to this open share tray, right?
Open share tray, correct. And share your PPT part.
But then what is the next? Okay, desktop.
Yes. Yeah, you just select that window.
Just
say share. You can shift the tab.
Pardon?
You can shift that tab to the your PPT. Your window is visible to us.
So my PPT is visible?
Not PPT, the other screen is visible, sir.
Is it visible now?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
PPT?
Yeah, PPT is visible, sir.
Okay. Do I need to do anything now?
You can just enlarge and you can go ready to go. I will take your 1 minute, sir. Before starting a session, I request all the participants to mute their mics, please. Also switch off the videos, because there is no need for your mic as well as videos.
Particularly, you can put your question in the chat.
Yeah, if you have any questions, you are most welcome. You can type in the chat box. So at the end of session, we'll take your questions. Dr. Shevadkar, sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. I think my PPT is not visible now.
No, it's not visible. When you again switch on, then it will be visible, sir.
So is it that my video is visible?
Your video is also not visible, sir.
Okay. 1 minute. And now PPT is visible. Right?
Yeah, PPT is visible, sir.
Okay. So I shall go ahead now.
Yes, sir. Please
take over for another one and a half hour.
Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
You can enlarge the PPT and it's just ready to go, sir.
Yeah. I'll do that. I hope the PPT is clearly visible now in the enlarge mode.
Yes, sir, clearly visible.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Chandrakant Sonone, for a nice introduction. And I'm thankful to you for giving me an opportunity to deliver an expert lecture, especially on the basics in computational fluid dynamics. I welcome all the participants to this first session in the FDP on advances in computational fluid dynamics. Let me tell you, I am currently working with Government College of Engineering and Research, Ausari, which is located 60 kilometers from Pune in the districts of Pune itself. It's located in the rural area and was started way back in 2010 by Government of Maharashtra. And currently, the institute is running undergraduate programs. Prior to this, a year ago, till year ago, I used to work with College of Engineering Pune, where I could gain some good experience, and which I am going to share with all of you. And although the title of the this particular slide looks like a pure diffusion problems in computational fluid dynamics and heat transfer, I'll be first introducing you to what is CFD, and then I will take you through finite volume method or finite volume approach for dealing with some basic problems in computational fluid dynamics. And let me again tell you, I am going to take you through the solution of entire Navier-Stokes equation as we proceed to the next sessions as well. So let me begin. At the beginning itself, let me clarify one thing, the most important thing in fluid mechanics and heat transfer, the most important, which all of you should note. Many of you must be youngsters, many of you must be aspiring for your PhDs, many of you must be carrying out your own research in maybe fluid dynamics and heat transfer, maybe in chemical engineering also. In almost all the problems, the most important objective of obtaining this solution is to determine the velocity distribution, pressure distribution, and temperature distribution, if even the heat transfer is involved. The moment you determine the moment, let's say you have a small body for which the flow is occurring, and if you want to find out the drag experienced by the body, the lift experienced by the body, I mean to say the forces experienced by the body, what you need to first find out the velocity distribution around the body and pressure distribution around the body. The moment you know the velocity distribution, the moment you know the pressure distribution, you can calculate the parameter which is of engineering importance, especially drag and lift. The drag can be, of course, expressed in terms of drag coefficient, or lift can be expressed in terms of lift coefficient. Similarly, in heat transfer problem, let's say if you have a simple body which is heated and over which, let's say there is a flow occurring. The moment you know the temperature distribution around the body, you can calculate the heat transfer coefficient. And all of you know, determining the heat transfer coefficient is the main issue in any heat transfer problems. I mean to say 99% problems in convection heat transfers deals with determination of heat transfer coefficient, which further can be obtained in terms of Nusselt number also. So, finding out the solution in terms of velocity, pressure, and temperature is the most important issue. Once you find out the velocity, pressure, and temperature, you can determine all engineering parameters which are of importance, especially, for example, drag coefficient, lift coefficient, Nusselt number, maybe friction resistance in the pipe, whatever. Even if you want to determine vorticity, you can calculate it from the velocity data. Whatever engineering parameter which is of importance you want to calculate can be calculated once you know the velocity and pressure distribution in the flow domain or temperature in the heat transfer domain. Now, how to calculate this velocity, pressure, or how to obtain the velocity and pressure is the major issue. And for that, you have certain approaches traditionally certain approaches include dynamics. The solutions, analytical solutions to these problems are available for limited cases, but those are extremely useful. And then there are large number of equations available, like Navier-Stokes equation, continuity equations. Those equations can be solved. There are some complex methods also available, like and complex algebra is used, but those methods are tedious. Many times people carry out non-dimensionalization and they do the dimensional analysis to obtain the solution. But then that is based on your understanding of the physical problem. There are experimental methods also available, which are possible for only global parameters. See, with experimental methods, you cannot take your sensor or measuring probe to every nook and corner in the flow domain. It's really difficult. And then making an experimental setup, all of you must be aware of, it's really time consuming. Many times you are dependent on other people, and it is really difficult to obtain the solution for the solution in terms of velocity distribution or pressure distribution in the entire domain. So the alternative is, or at least a complementary method, is of course a computational fluid dynamics, which came with the birth of electronic computer. The performance to cost ratio of computers increased at a spectacular rate in last 10 years or so, and it doesn't show any sign of slowing down even today. So I mean, the speed of a computer is increasing. Further increases in both computing speed and memory of the affordable computers are certain. The solution of equations of fluid mechanics on computers, I mean, if we are able to solve those complex equations in fluid mechanics, which all of you have learned, like you have learned continuity equation, you have learned momentum equations like Euler equation or Navier-Stokes equation or Reynolds equation, then if you are able to solve those equations, of course there is no analytical solution available to Navier-Stokes equation. If you are able to solve those equations using computers, of course it has become so important and it occupies the attention of perhaps third of all the researchers in the fluid mechanics. And the proportion is increasing. Let me tell you, each and every researcher who is working in the area of fluid mechanics and heat transfer, he has started using computers for obtaining the solution. And this field is essentially known as computational fluid dynamics. What is CFD? Flows and related phenomena can be described by partial differential equation. These partial differential equations cannot be solved analytically, and hence there is an alternative to obtain the numerical solution. To obtain the numerical solution, one has to convert those differential or integral form of governing equations like Navier-Stokes equation or the continuity equation, energy equation, into an algebraic equation. So that process of converting differential equation or integral form of equation into algebraic equation is called a discretization. So we need to make in terms of some equations, convert those equations into an algebraic equation, solve those algebraic equations using numerical methods, and that's CFD. So once you obtain this solution to, and solution, of course, solution is for velocity, solution is for pressure, and solution temperature, and that's important. Solution for these parameters is known to you. You can determine any of the engineering parameters. Let me tell you, any of the engineering parameters, once you know velocity, pressure, and temperature distribution in the flow domain and flow and heat transfer domain. So that's CFD. I have tried to give you it in a nutshell. I'm going to take you through some basics as we proceed ahead. We must be able to compare this definition of CFD with that of the experiments as well. Let me tell you, the accuracy of the experiment depends on the tools of measurement. Similarly, the accuracy of CFD depends on quality of discretization. What is discretization? As I said, it's conversion of differential equation into an approximate form, into algebraic form. Because my computer does not understand differential equation, I need to make use of algebraic equations. And how do we convert these? Based on that, the accuracy of the CFD solution is based on the quality. What are the major components of CFD? I mean, many times I'm going to use this word numerical solution method, because in CFD we solve the equations numerically. We don't solve those equations analytically. You must have a clear understanding between numerical and analytical solution. The various components are mathematical model, I mean to say various governing equations, then discretization method. I am going to deal with the finite discretization methods available, like finite difference method, but which is obsolete. There is a finite element method also, which is mostly used for solid mechanics. And there is a finite volume method, which is largely used by the people working in the area of fluid dynamics. It also consists of a coordinate and a basis vector systems. Like, for example, it depends on the kind of domain. Based on that, we can decide whether we need to go for Cartesian coordinate system, cylindrical coordinate system, spherical coordinate system, and so on and so forth. To carry out the discretization of the equations, we also need to discretize the domain. And discretization of the flow domain is called numerical grid. That's also an important component. Maybe somebody will talk about grid generation. Then finite approximations, we are going to deal with this. I mean, how to convert equations from, especially from differential form or integral form to that of the algebraic form. And then how to solve those algebraic equations, that is a solution method. And then we need to decide certain convergence criteria, which is also an important aspect of component of the computational fluid dynamics. So among these various things, what we are going to deal especially is a discretization method and maybe finite approximations and solution method. Maybe a little bit we will talk about convergence criteria also, if the time permits. For other things, maybe somebody else will talk as we proceed ahead. There are certain properties of a CFD solution, which are mathematical aspects, which I don't want to go through the details of it, but your solution need to be consistent, it need to be stable, it need to be convergence, there has to be conservation of the flow properties like momentum and the mass, then boundedness, realizability and accuracy. These are some of the important aspects you must look at when you develop your own solution methodology. Now let me start with the first part of the things, that is governing equation. Let me tell you, the entire fluid mechanics and heat transfer is based on three basic principles. The first basic principle is principle of conservation of mass, which all of you have studied. And this principle of conservation of mass leads to an equation called continuity equation. In the dimensional form, this continuity equation is written as divergence of rho u vector is equal to zero. All of you must have studied continuity equation. In the expanded form, I can write down continuity equation as del u by del x plus del v by del y is equal to zero. All of you must be aware about this. This being an advanced CFD Pro course, I need not to go through the details of these governing equations as said, but I must tell you. The second important principle is principle of conservation of momentum. The principle of conservation of momentum gives you different types of equations depending on your assumption. If you assume that your fluid is ideal, what you get is a Euler equation. And Euler equation considers only the pressure force and the body force experienced by the fluid particle. It doesn't take into consideration the viscous forces. And it goes like this, del by del t of rho u vector plus divergence of rho u vector u vector. U vector is a velocity vector, is equal to minus grad of p plus, if the fluid is viscous fluid, if the fluid is a real fluid and the flow is laminar, then I need to consider the viscous forces. So that is represented by mu into grad square u vector plus body force. The body force may be the force because of gravity, force because of buoyancy, force because of magnetic force, whatever. We can keep on adding those. So this equation is nothing but essentially a momentum equation. Momentum equation when we consider viscous force, it becomes a Navier-Stokes equation. If we neglect this particular force, then it becomes a Euler equation. On to left hand side of this equation, you will find you have rate of change of momentum. These two terms represent rate of change of momentum, and we all know rate of change of momentum is the force. So this is pressure force, this is viscous force, this is body force. In the expanded form, I can write down this equation for x direction as well as y direction. So you can look at this del by del t of rho u, which represent the unsteadiness in the flow, del by del x of rho u plus del by del y of rho vu. On to other side, I have minus del p by del x plus mu into del 2 u by del x square plus del 2 u by del y square. Maybe body force term is also there, which I have not written here. If I take rho on to other side of the equation, what I am left with is del by del u of del by del t of u. What is del by del t of u? It's acceleration. Similarly, here it will be del by del x of uu, del by del y of vu. These are all acceleration. This is my temporal acceleration and this is my convective acceleration. And acceleration is always equal to force upon mass. So if I take rho onto this side, this becomes my pressure force per unit mass. This becomes my viscous force per unit mass. So that's how x momentum equation can be written. Similarly, I can write down y momentum equation. Similar to this, I have an energy equation for heat transfer. Del by del t of rho t plus divergence of rho u vector t plus k by Cp. I can write it as rho, I can take onto this side, and I can write k by rho Cp, which will represent thermal diffusivity, grad square t plus q bar. Q bar is a heat generation rate. So now look at these equations carefully. I have continuity equation, I have x momentum equation, I have y momentum equation, and I have energy equation as well. So if I consider the flow to be two-dimensional, these equations are written considering flow to be a two-dimensional. So, Sonone sir, am I going right correctly?
Yes, sir. Absolutely okay, sir.
The voice is clear and everything is fine. No?
Yes, sir. No, absolutely clear.
Okay.
You are going very smooth, sir.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you.
Yes,
sir. So, I have 1, 2, 3 and 4 equations, which is an energy equation. Fourth equation is energy equation. In all these equations, what is my objective? My objective is to obtain the solution for the variable like u velocity, which is x direction velocity, v velocity, which is y direction velocity, p, which is a pressure, And rho is, of course, not known to me. It is a variable, dependent variable. U, V, P, rho, and temperature. These are my dependent variable. And X, Y, and T, small t. These are my independent variables. So my objective is to obtain the solution to U as a function of X, Y, and T, solution to V as a function of X, Y, and T, solution to P as a function of X, Y, and T, and solution to temperature as a function of X, Y, and T. If I am able to solve these equations and obtain the solution to U, V, P, and T, then I can determine any of the engineering parameter. Of course, U, V, P, and T has to be determined at all X, Y locations and at all time instances. So U, V, P, and temperature, these are the functions of X, Y, and time. If I am able to find out that, my job is done. Rest is all engineering. Rest is all engineering. So what we are going to do, we are going to deal with the solution methodology which will help us to solve these equations. I cannot develop the understanding of the solution of these equations in one go. And all the equations we take together, continuity, x momentum, y momentum, and we try to solve those, it doesn't happen. So what we need to do, we need to take a simple cases. For example, let's consider this energy equation. What we will do, we will assume a simple case that my flow is steady. So this unsteady term will go away. The first term is unsteady term. Now this is a general equation I have written. It is del phi by del t. Phi can be either u, v, or capital T, plus del by del x of rho u phi. Again, phi can be u, v, or t. For x momentum equation, it is u. For y momentum equation, it is v. For energy equation, it is t, capital T. Similarly here, del by del y of rho v t phi. Phi, this is u, v, or capital T, depending on whether. So these two particular terms represent the convection. It's a convection of momentum if I consider the momentum equation, or it is a convection of heat if I consider the heat energy equation. On the other side, I have this diffusion term, diffusion of a momentum or diffusion of a heat. If it's a momentum equation, it's a diffusion. If we consider the heat energy equation, it's a diffusion of heat, which we also call conduction. And then there is a source term. This is Q bar in case of energy equation, and it is body force plus pressure force in case of momentum equation. So these are the fundamental equations which we need to solve. All of you must have studied these equations during your undergraduate course, during your postgraduate program, and maybe during your PhD as well. Because many of you are having a background of fluid dynamics and heat transfer. So now what we are going to do, we are going to take a simple case. Let's say my heat transfer, I'm going to deal with the heat transfer problem. Let's say I'm going to assume that my heat transfer is steady. So this term will go away. I'm going to assume that there is no convection, so all these terms will go away. I'm going to assume that there is no heat generation, so this term will go away. And what I will be left with? Only del 2 t by del x square plus del 2 t by del y square is equal to 0. In the next case, what I will do? I will consider only this term. I will assume that there is no diffusion. There is no conduction of heat. I will assume a certain situation. And we'll try to obtain the solution to the problem wherein only convection, pure convection occurs. Then what we will do, we will consider the same case wherein convection and conduction both occurs. And then once we are able to understand how these problems can be solved, then we will switch over to the entire Navier-Stokes equation. So we are going to go ahead step by step. We will first deal with a pure conduction problem. Then we will deal with a pure convection problem. Then we will deal with conduction-convection problem. And lastly, we will deal with the entire solution of entire Navier-Stokes equation. So let us start with the pure diffusion problem. If it's a fluid flow, of course, a pure diffusion problem doesn't occur in the fluid flow, but then hypothetically, we can say incompressible inviscid flow, which is normally represented as grad square psi is equal to zero, is a pure diffusion problem. Psi is a stream function here. Similarly, in heat transfer, if it is an unsteady flow, we have an equation. If it is an unsteady flow, I have equation like this. It is del by del T of rho Cp. I have miss rho here. There has to be rho in this term. So del by del T of rho Cp. On the other side, we have k into del 2 t by del x square plus del 2 t by del y square plus q bar if my heat transfer is unsteady. So this is my pure conduction equation. If it is steady, of course, this term will go away. And if there is no heat generation also, we can simply say grad square t is equal to 0. That is del 2 t by del x square plus del 2 t by del y square is equal to 0. If it is a steady, so this is grad square t is equal to 0. For unsteady state, this is the, so these equations essentially represent a pure diffusion phenomena. Here it is a diffusion of momentum. Here it is a diffusion of heat. Here it's a diffusion of heat in unsteady state heat transfer process. Here it is diffusion of heat in the steady state heat transfer problem. Now what we are going to do, we will be taking a simple case. And in this simple case, there is a pure conduction occurring. The case is like this. There is a square plate which is maintained at different boundary conditions. Like, let's say this boundary is at a temperature of TW, which is constant. Let's say this boundary is insulated. Let's say this boundary is subjected to some heat flux. And let's say this boundary is subjected to the situation where conduction, whatever heat is conducted to this boundary, is being converted. The environmental condition are H and to T infinity. I want to find out, if this is the situation, I want to find out how the temperature distribution will look like. That's my aim. A simple problem I want to solve. I want to determine the temperature distribution as a function of X and Y. Let's assume that the problem is a steady state problem. This is the situation. How do we adopt finite volume methodology to obtain the temperature distribution? That's what is our objective. With this objective, if we want to go ahead, the first and the most important step in this is to discretize this domain. So this is my heat transfer domain now. In this, the heat transfer is going to occur, and my objective is to obtain the temperature distribution. The first and the most important step is I have to decide at how many locations and at what locations I want to find out the temperatures. Let's say I want to find out it at 25 points. I want to find it at 50 points, 100 points, and so on and so forth, whatever. But I need to decide that. To decide this, what we do? We first discretize this domain. That is also called a grid generation. What we do? We draw few vertical lines. Let's say here we are drawing equipace line, few horizontal lines, and then we locate the center. Then by drawing the horizontal and vertical lines, what we get are the small control volumes, which are also called cells. The centers of these cells can be called cell centers. Here I am just giving you a certain representative cell center P. And then capital E is a east neighboring cell center. Capital N is a north neighboring cell center. This is west neighboring cell center. This is south neighboring cell center. So all these yellow dots which are shown here are the cell centers of a control volume. And then there are certain blue dots I have drawn here. These blue dots are nothing but the cell centers which are lying on the boundaries of the flow domain, heat transfer domain, and around these cell centers there are the cells with a zero control, zero volume. Here I have a cell which has got a certain volume, let's say this is my delta x and delta y, then I have the volume of this cell as delta x into delta y. If it is a 2D problem, let's assume that in third direction the dimension is unity. So essentially the blue one which I have drawn are the boundary cell centers. These are all boundary cell centers, and the boundaries, we assume that there are the cells on the boundary with zero volume. Now all these cell centers are required to be nomenclated. We nomenclate it using running indices and I and J. So I and J are the running indices. So for example, if I consider this cell center, the running index of this cell center will be I is equal to 2 and J is equal to 2. So I start from here. This is I is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. This is I max. My J starts from here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. Here J max is 7. I arbitrarily divided this domain into 5 by 5 cells. Then when I nomenclate these, I can nomenclate this nomenclature is essential to assign certain values. We will learn that as we proceed ahead. For example, if I want to nomenclate these boundaries, left boundary cell centers, how do I write those? Here my I is equal to 1 and J is equal to 2 to J max minus 1. Does that, I hope this makes sense. If it is my right boundary, then I is equal to I max and J is equal to 2 to J max minus 1. If this is the boundary, I can say my I is equal to 2 to I max minus 1 and J is equal to 1. This boundary I can represent as I is equal to I is equal to 2 to I max minus 1 and J is equal to J max. All other cell centers I can represent as I is equal to 2 to I max minus 1 and J is equal to 2 to J max minus 1. So this is a discrete representation of a domain, which is also called a grid generation. Now only representing it diagrammatically doesn't make any sense. We need, when we go ahead with the solution of the equation, we also need to derive certain geometric information from this discretization of the domain. And that geometric information is this. I need to first calculate the x and y coordinates of each and every cell center. For each and every cell center, I need to calculate. How do I get that? To calculate, I know where I have drawn the vertical and horizontal lines. So I know the coordinates of vertices. These are the vertices. This is my northeast vertex. This is northwest. This is southwest. This is southeast vertex. I know the x coordinates of these vertices as well as y coordinates of these vertices. If I take the average of all these four, what I obtain? X and y coordinates of point P. So that's what is done here. So first I need to calculate x and y coordinates of all the cell centers. Next I need to calculate these are the faces of my cell or the control volume. Sonone sir, are you there?
Yes sir, I am there, sir.
So I have one question. If participant want to ask certain question, how do they ask?
Sir, they are asking through chat box, sir.
They are asking.
If you wish to ask them, so you can have a pause of say 10 minutes and you can take a question. So they can they can switch on their mic and they can directly ask you, sir.
The chat box is not available for the participants.
That we are enabling, sir. Just our administrator is enabling that. So it will be available in 10 minutes, sir.
So is there any question by the way currently?
Sir, meanwhile, if you want to take some questions, so that you can take a pause, you can have a water and all those things, and you can interact with participants.
Okay, I'll do that.
That will also be a good idea.
By the way, is there any question till now?
Dr. Sevatkar, sir, your cursor is not visible when you're showing something now. You're saying something this and this. That's not, your cursor is not moving.
Oh, this cursor is not moving now?
Yeah.
Oh, but it's moving here. I don't know what.
It's not in our screen.
Is that the case with everybody?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Same problem.
Yes, sir.
सर
यू कैन राइट क्लिक ऑन द पीपीटी देन इट शोज अ पॉइंटर ऑप्शन
इन द पीपीटी इटसेल्फ सर
Sir, in the PPT.
Here?
Yes, sir.
Size position. Bring to front. Change picture.
Sir, please make PPT in full screen so that the option can come.
Oh, is it? Oh, 1 minute. Show the pointer options are there.
Okay. Yes, sir. Pointer option mein laser pointer, sir.
Is this visible? Is this my?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Yes, sir.
My pointer is visible.
Visible.
Now.
Thank. Is it visible or not?
Yes, sir. Visible.
Thank you very much for bringing this to my notice.
Any questions from participant? You can raise your hand so I can add. You can take questions for 5 minutes.
Hello,
Dr. Shivatkar can have a water and have some rest.
No. You can go ahead, please, if you have a question.
Hello, Shivatkar, sir.
Any participant have some questions?
Yeah, myself, Umesh Podar from Pune. I want to ask the question. Can you repeat this IMAX and I or J and J Max once, please?
Yeah. I can definitely do that.
Yeah, thank you.
See, when we have drawn these vertical and horizontal lines, what we have obtained are the small control volumes or cells. Now these cells are to be identified with certain coordinates. For that, what we do, we locate the cell centers. Now, these cell centers, in order to represent the cell center in terms of x and y coordinates, these cell centers are required to be nomenclated. So what we do, we nomenclate the horizontal, we nomenclate cell center using I and J running indices. The running indices goes like this. Along x direction, it goes like this. This is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, this is 5, this is 6, and 7, and so on. Vertically, it goes along. The running index is J. 1, 2, 3, 4. I think somebody has kept his mic, the microphone on. And,
please mute your these things. Shivatkar, sir, you can unmute. I have done the all unmute. Dr. Shivatkar, you can do unmute on your mic, please. Yeah, thank you.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. I have done mute all. So as I am organizer, so all are get muted.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that I will do once again, mind. Yes, sir. Please go on, sir.
Yeah. So So the sales centers are required to be essentially nomenclated, and we do that using running indices I and J. My cursor may not be visible again. Let me.
It's not visible, sir.
Now it is visible, right?
Now it's visible, sir.
Okay. So running indices are required to be. So this is 1, 2, 3 along X direction, 1, 2, 3 along Y direction. And we nomenclate all these cell center using running indices so that to that nomenclature, we are able to assign certain value. How do we assign certain value? For example, here I calculate XP, that is X coordinate of point P, Y coordinate of point P. I calculate it by using the coordinates of the X and Y coordinate of vertices, which are known to us because we know where we have drawn the lines. So XNE plus XSC plus XSW plus XNW divided by 4, that's average. That gives me X coordinate of point P, similarly Y coordinate of point P. Then I can also calculate the size of the faces. So this is my east face, this is west face, north face, and south face of cell under consideration. So delta XC is XSC minus XSW. XSC is nothing but this point. This is XSW. So if I take the difference between two, what I obtain is delta X. Similarly, I can calculate delta Y. This information is required when we develop the approximate or the discretized equation or algebraic equation as we go ahead. Further, I also need to know the distance between neighboring cell centers. So this is my east neighboring cell center. This is cell center under consideration. The distance between two is represented by delta XE. And this delta XE can be obtained by XE minus XP. Because I know the X coordinate of E point and X coordinate of P point. These X coordinates of all the points can be calculated using this expression. So I can write down expression for delta XE like this. Similarly, I can calculate delta YS, delta YN, delta XW. Delta XW is distance between point under consideration and the west neighboring cell center. This is delta XW. So this time I can write down XP minus XW. This is XP minus XW. Similarly, delta YS. Delta YN, I can determine all these parameters. So these are nothing but the distances between neighboring cell center. I also need to calculate, as a part of my grid generation, the area of faces. For example, area of east face and area of Y face is delta Y. Let me also tell you, areas are the vector quantities, the area through which fluid comes in. If I consider that as positive, the area through which it goes out can be considered as negative. Here, what we are doing, I am assuming that the heat is coming from this end. So the heat is going out through east face, for example. So I consider that area as positive. So this area becomes negative. So delta SE is the area of east face, which is also equal to minus delta SW. This is equal to delta Y. There is a typographical mistake. I'm sorry for this. I'll correct it in my presentation. This is delta Y. Similarly, delta SN is also equal to delta SS, but with a negative sign. This is also equal to delta X. These two are required to be interchangeable. Please keep the note of this. And delta X and delta Y are known to us because we have calculated it earlier. Similarly, when I go ahead with the solution, I also need to know the volume of each and every cell. And delta Vp is the volume of a cell, and it is given by delta X into delta Y. So for calculating volume, also I need to know the size of the faces. And for calculating areas of the faces, I need to know the size of the faces. So this is all grid generation. I mean, in a grid generation, I need to determine all this information. This information is very, very important for me. And now presently for this problem, we are considering a simple grid, but grids are many times complex. Grid generation is itself a topic or itself a course. There are courses offered on grid generation. There are books available on grid generation. So I'm not going to take you through those details at this point of time because our objective is to understand finite volume method. Now let us come to the equation. Hitherto, what we have done, we have discretized the domain. Now we will be discretizing the equation. I'm now going to consider the steady state diffusion problem. The steady state.
Sir, conduction.
Yes.
Sir, I have a doubt. Whatever grid you have shown, whether all the equations will be applicable only for uniform grid. Whatever equations.
No. Till now I have not talked anything about the correlation of equations and grid.
Okay.
See, the equations are independent in their own nature, and those equations can be applied to any type of grids. But how does those equations?
Sir, I mean to say that whatever the distances you have calculated of the center, whether it is applicable only for the uniform grid or if the grid is non-uniform also, the same things will be applicable.
Say, yeah, if you prepare a non-uniform grid for every cell, the same equations will be applicable. No? The same equations will be applicable. I mean, as long as the grid is structured grid. I mean, in case of grids like if there are O-rings, if there are C-rings, there are other equations you need to develop. What I am trying to tell you is the methodology as to how to go ahead. How to calculate the distances between two that sometimes if the nature of the grid changes, those equations may change.
Okay, fine, sir. Got it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So now we are coming to the discretization of equation. I am going to deal with the steady state diffusion problem. So for steady state diffusion problem, the exact representation of the governing equation is integral over delta V grad square phi dV. Phi is nothing but, in our case, it is temperature. I'm using this I'm representing it using phi. dV is the operator. Now this is the exact representation of a steady state heat conduction problem in the integral form. Now this is volumetric integral. This volumetric integral can be converted into surface integral using Gauss divergence theorem. And when we do so, one of the grad disappears from the equation, and the equation and this operator changes to area operator. This is volumetric operator. This is area operator. So integral over delta S grad of phi dot n cap ds. N cap is to be introduced to which represents the unit vector in the normal direction. So this grad has to be taken in the direction which is a normal direction. Now this integral is written for the entire surface area of a cell center. Now the cell center consists of east, west, north, south areas, faces. So what we can do, we can disintegrate it into four and then write it in the form of a summation. For example, I can disintegrate it as an integral over delta SE, that is for east face, into grad of del phi by del x into DSE, that is operator for east face. Similarly, I can do it for west face, I can do it for north face and south face, and then I can sum it up. So summation over the faces east, west, north, south of integral over delta SF. Now F stands for east, west, north, south. Del phi by del N, this is a normal gradient, into DSF. This DSF is either DSE, DSW, DSN or DSS. So this is my exact representation of the steady state governing equation, which can be approximated to. Now what I am doing, I assume that this particular gradient for a particular phase is constant. For example, let's say I want to find out the gradient for east phase. I can do it by considering temperature here. So temperature at east phase minus temperature at point P divided by distance between two. That can be used as a representation of gradient across east phase. Now this gradient value I will be obtaining at a point joining the two, at a point of intersections of the line joining these two points and the phase, that is at this point. I assume that the same gradient prevails over the entire surface and it is constant for a particular instant, and then I take it out of the integral sign, assuming it as constant. And what is left inside the integral sign is now DSF. And the integral of DSF is delta SF. So my equation now can be approximated to summation over east, west, north, south phases into del by del n of phi for various phases into delta SF. I hope this is clear to you. So this is, now this particular quantity del phi by del n can be replaced as del phi by del n can be replaced as phi e minus phi p upon delta x e. Phi e minus phi p divided by these two quantity is del, is the, is del phi by del n for east phase. Delta sf is delta s e. Similarly, for west phase, is phi p minus phi w it is phi p minus phi w divided by delta x w. Of course multiplied by delta s w. So this is the quantity here. Similarly, for north phase, it is phi n minus phi p divided by delta y n into delta s n. For south phase, it is phi p minus phi s upon delta y s into delta s s. Do remember this delta s w and delta s s, these are the negative areas. We have said at the beginning itself that the areas are negative quantities. Area is negative, is a vector quantity. So now, what we have done here, you look at this equation, this is an algebraic equation. This can be set to equal to zero. If I am able to set this equal to zero, and then if I make use of certain boundary conditions, I can obtain the solution of this equation for phi p. I can find out mu phi p. We'll see how do we do that. For example, if I want to find out it for the pure interior cell, let's say I want to find out what I need to do, I need to make certain initial guess for the temperature. So from initial guess, and maybe I know certain boundary conditions, from the boundary conditions I know the values of temperatures at all the points. That is of course from initial guess. For any numerical solution you need to make initial guess. So I know the temperatures at each and every point, either from initial guess or from the boundary condition. And then what I need to do, I want to find out the new value. I want to iterate it now. If I want to find out the temperature at point P, this is known to me from initial guess, this is known to me, this is known to me, this is known to me. Now, what I have done here, I have given you here the simplified equations, which are essentially not required, but simplified equations, if you make use of, you can do manual calculations very quickly to understand the actual process of calculating the new values of temperatures. So if I have this equation, if you look at delta XC and delta AC, these, in this particular problem, my grid is uniform structured. So the value of delta XC and delta AC are same, especially for two-dimensional problem. So I can cancel this out and I'm left with phi E minus phi P is plus phi P minus phi W. But now here, this is a negative quantity. So this negative and this negative becomes positive and phi P becomes negative. So this is negative phi P, this is negative phi P. Similarly here, this is negative phi P. This phi P will become negative because my delta SS is negative. So I have four negative phi P's and I have phi E plus phi W plus phi N plus phi SS. This will become plus, this will become plus because this quantity is negative. After canceling out, minus one remains. So that gives me an equation phi P is equal to phi W plus phi S plus phi E plus phi N divided by four. So for this equation I can write for pure interior control cell centers. But if I have, let's say, border control volume, this is my left border control volume. My neighboring cell center distance is delta XW divided by 2. Here it is, it is delta X by 2. So in this equation, when I cancel out these two terms with each other, 2 goes in the numerator. So I have 2 phi p's here and 2 phi w's. And hence, my equation changes to, if it is a left border interior control volume, my phi p is 2 phi w plus phi s plus phi e plus phi n divided by 5. Because I have 5 phi p's now. For right border, it is right border. Here I have this distance as delta x by 2. So delta. So, and this is east face. So I will have appropriately for right border, I have 2 phi e's. And of course, phi w plus phi s plus 2 phi e upon phi plus phi n divided by 5. That is for the bottom and top also we can do like this. For the corner points, if I want to find out the temperature at the corner points, this point and let's say this. Here I have west face, I have delta x by 2 and even south face, I have delta y by 2. So that goes, 2 goes in the numerator and I get 6 phi p's. So left bottom, I have 2 phi w, 2 phi s, and here I have in the denominator 6. So I can develop these kinds of equations to carry out some manual calculations and obtain the values of new phi p's. I can find out new phi p values. And then if the difference between new values and the old values is minimum, I can say that I have reached to the steady state temperature distribution. If not, I can carry out the next iteration, keep on carrying out the next iteration. Of course, to carry out the iteration, we need to first make certain initial guess, and we need to know how the boundary conditions are. We need to know the temperatures at the boundary points using boundary conditions. We will talk about boundary conditions also. See, we have so far seen the discretization of the domain. Then we have seen the discretization of the governing equation. Now we will look at the discretization of the boundary conditions. Your boundary conditions are also required to be discretized. Do remember this. Your boundary conditions, in whatever physical form are known to you, you must know finally it in terms of temperature. Because you are calculating the temperatures at the inner cell centers, you must know the temperatures at the boundaries. For example, here if I have the insulated boundary condition, it means I have del T by del Y is equal to 0, but del T by del Y is equal to 0 cannot be understood by my computer. So I need to express the temperature at this boundary in terms of some value of temperature. How do I do that? For example, let's say if this boundary is at a temperature of constant, at some constant temperature TW, I can assign that this is TW, this is TW, this is TW, this is W. But if it is insulated here, how much temperature I am going to assign here? I need to assign some temperature because it is required in order to calculate the temperature at these points. So in order to calculate temperatures at this point, I know my equation is del T by del Y is equal to zero. Now I can write down del T in terms of the difference between these two points and del Y in terms of distance between these two points. So this is my, let's say, TI1, this is TI2, this is TI3, this is TI4, right? This is T1, 2, this is T1, 3, this is T1, 4, this is T1, 5. Now, so I is varying, I is varying and the difference between these two temperatures can be written as TI2, TI2 minus TI1. This is the difference between temperature, and the distance between two is delta Y by 2. So this gives me TI1 is equal to TI2. So whatever is the temperature of this point is equal to temperature of these points. So temperature of the boundary is expressed in terms of temperature of the inner cell center, border cell center, to be more precise, border cell center. So this is how we can express the temperature. So it does mean that when I am carrying out the iteration, after every iteration, the temperature of the boundary also changes. Here, the temperature of the boundary does not change with respect to iteration, but here it changes. This boundary condition, QW is equal to constant, I can express it as my, I know the expression for QW. QW is equal to minus K dT by dx. Now, dT by dx, I can replace as the difference between these two temperatures divided by distance between the two. It gives me an equation TI max J. This is my TI max and J is varying. So TI max J is equal to TI max minus 1J of plus QW upon K into delta X by 2. This distance is delta X by 2. So that appears here. And QW is, of course, heat transfer across this surface. This is QW. So I can write down expressions like this. Similarly, I can find write down the expression for here. I can say minus K dT by dy is equal to H delta T. Delta T is temperature difference between this environment temperature difference between the difference between the environment temperature and the temperature at this point. And then using minus K dT H delta T, I can write down the expression like this to obtain the temperature at these points. So this is how, this is what is the discrete representation of the boundary condition. I have tried to cover all types of boundary conditions here. This is my Dirichlet boundary condition, which you must have learned, where the variable is constant. This is a non-Dirichlet boundary condition, or it is also called Neyman boundary condition. This is also Neyman boundary condition, where the derivative of the variable is constant. And this is my Robin boundary condition or mixed boundary condition, where we have the combination of these two boundary conditions. We have tried to, I have tried to cover all the boundary conditions here, and I have tried to explain you the how to discretize those boundary conditions. So now, having done this, I will tell you how to write the algorithm for obtaining solution to such kind of problem. What we do, manually we can make use of these equations, and manually we can kind of calculate the temperature at these points. If I want to calculate temperature at this point, for example, I need to know this temperature, this temperature, this and this temperature, and by using these equations I can then calculate the new value of temperature, and I can go ahead through the iterations. But then it's not possible to do the manual calculation when the number of points are large. When we want to find out the temperature at large number of points, then in that case we need to use computers, and when we make use of a computer or when we develop certain code, we need to know the algorithm. So I'm going to discuss this algorithm here. At the first step, what we do, we enter the inputs like material properties, geometric parameters like L1 and L2. L1 and L2 is the size of the plate, square plate, maximum number of control volumes in X and Y direction. Here in this case, we said 5555 numbers on X and Y direction, but then the numbers, if you increase the number of points, you get better solution. Then some boundary condition inputs, like for example here, H and T infinity has to be given, QW has to be given. All these parameters you should define at the beginning. And EPS, EPS is epsilon. Epsilon is required in order to decide upon the convergence criteria. For example, we can determine the RMS value of the temperatures which we have found out. And then from that RMS value, we can decide whether my solution has converged or not. We'll see how to do that as we proceed ahead. Then next step is a grid generation. We calculate all the geometric parameters of all the control volumes. Which geometric parameters will you find out? These geometric parameters. Which is all these geometric parameters are required in the solution process, which you must have seen. See this equation? In this equation, if you equate it with zero, you need all those geometric parameters which we have calculated as a part of grid generation. And set the initial guess for phi ij's. You have to set the value of, you have to set the values of, you have to give the initial guess to, the initial values you have to assume for all the cell centers. And then at this step, you can also define all the Dirichlet boundary condition. As I said, Dirichlet boundary condition means that boundary condition in which the variable is constant. This does not change with respect to iteration. However, the non-Dirichlet boundary condition, for example, if it is insulated, the temperature at the boundary is a function of temperature at the inner cell center. That's what we have seen from this equation, Ti1 is equal to Ti2. Here also, this is non-Dirichlet boundary condition. The temperature on the boundary is a function of inner temperature. Here also, the temperature on the boundary is a function of inner temperature. So the moment you go into the next iteration, you need to change the boundary conditions also. So what we do, we set the non-Dirichlet boundary conditions separately, because after every iteration, you have to come back to this step. Having done this, what we do next is we set whatever, so from the initial guess and from the initial guess and boundary conditions, I know the temperatures of each and every cell center. What I do, and that is phi ij. I assign that phi ij to another variable, which is phi old ij. So what we do, whatever is available with me, I make it old. And then by using these old values, I calculate new values. How do I calculate new values? I calculate new values by using these equations. Or I can simply set this equal to zero and I can calculate phi p, because that's only unknown. Phi e, phi w, phi n, phi s, these are known to me from my initial guess or boundary conditions. And delta SE, delta SW, delta SN, delta SS is known to me from my grid generation. And these distances are also known to me from my grid generation. So what is unknown to me is new value of phi p. I keep on calculating the new value of phi p. For example, if I start from here, I use these four values, neighboring cell center values. I know the distances between the neighboring cell centers. I know that the areas, so I can find out the new value here. I scroll through, I find out the value here, scroll through all the points, and I find out new values of phi p's. That's what we do here. For each interior or boundary control volume, calculate phi ij. Now, once you calculate phi ij, find out RMS phi. Summation over ij, phi ij minus phi old ij whole square divided by I max minus 2 into j max minus 2. why I max minus 2, J max minus 2? Because I need not to find out the value that the blue cells enter. My objective is to find out the value that yellow cells enters, which are interior. And how many interior cell centers I have? I have, I mean, so this is 1, 2, 3, 4, for example. So this is, these yellow numbers are nothing but it is I max minus 2. And on along y direction, it is J max minus 2. So for these many number of centers, cell centers, we are finding out solution, and hence in the denominator we have I max minus 2 into J max minus 2. And that gives me the RMS. It's a kind of a standard deviation. We call it as a root mean square value. This root mean square value of phi is less than epsilon, which we have defined at the beginning here. If it is less than epsilon, I have obtained the solution. If it is not, go back to step number 5, update the non-Dirichlet boundary, update the boundary conditions. I need not to go back to step number this step, because my in case of a Dirichlet boundary condition, the temperature are fixed, but in non-Dirichlet boundary conditions, the temperature are functions of inner cell center. So I need to update again, make everything old, calculate new, again check RMS phi, and keep on iterating till you satisfy this condition. Once you satisfy this condition, you can print the temperatures at all the yellow cell centers. So in the print command, you can say print x coordinate, y coordinate, and temperature of each and every point. So you will have three columns, x coordinate, y coordinate, and then that data you can use for processing your solution or looking at your solution from the for the physical understanding. Now for your understanding, what we have done, we have taken a simple one-dimensional steady state conduction equation in which governing equation is del 2 T by del X is equal to 0. Let's say the boundary conditions, the temperature here is TB1, temperature here is TB2, and if I want to find out the distribution, I divide it into number of cells. These are cell centers, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, these are cell centers. Then my finite volume equation is nothing but the summation of east and west face only, because I don't have, we don't have the north and south faces here. This is being a one-dimensional del T by del N of F into delta S, that can be written as T minus Tp upon delta X into delta S plus Tp minus Tw upon delta Sw to delta W. So this is all, this can be all set equal to zero, and this equation can be applied to point number 2, 3, 4, and 5, 6, and so on. I can write down such kind of equation to each and every point. And when I do that, and if I write down all those equations in the matrix form, I can obtain the coefficient matrix, variable matrix, and the boundary condition matrix like this. And I can solve these matrix maybe using. So this is, if you look at this, if it's a one-dimensional problem, you get a tri-diagonal matrix, and there are solutions available to obtain the solution. Methodology is available to obtain the tri-diagonal matrix. That's Jacobi and Seidel. What is the difference between Jacobi and Seidel? When we are obtaining the solution to, for example, this point, I need information from here, 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 and here. However, when I move to this point, now I need information from this point, this and this. But this information I have already determined just now. If I make use of that information, my methodology is Gauss-Seidel, else it is Gauss-Jacobi. If I use the initial guess itself for calculating the new value of this point, for calculating the new value of this point, if I make the recently available value, it is Gauss-Seidel, else it is Jacobi. So that's the difference. Those methods you must have studied during your undergraduate, postgraduate programs. So what I obtain is a tri-diagonal matrix, and you can either use Jacobi or Gauss-Seidel to obtain solution to such kind of problems. I'm just sharing with you the solution which we have obtained here. And for example, let's say if I have TB1 is equal to 0 and TB2 is equal to 100, then temperature distribution like a linear temperature diffusion, temperature distribution, and that's what we are obtaining here. So this confirms that the finite volume methodology which we are so far learned is working. It gives you a correct solution to temperature distribution. Similarly, there is another problem we considered, that this end is maintained at 100 degrees Celsius temperature and this end is subjected to certain convective boundary condition or Robin boundary condition wherein H and T infinity is known to you. If this is the situation, the temperature distribution is again linear, but the temperature in that case will definitely fall down. This problem you must have studied as a part of your heat transfer course, one-dimensional Phinn problem. So the Phinn is attached and the temperature distribution along the Phinn is to be calculated. We can see the validity of a finite volume method which we have learned through such kind of problem. See, we can do it once again. Here what we are doing, we are just changing the value of H. The moment my value of H increases, the temperature distribution will definitely change because my temperature distribution is bounded by the boundary conditions. So when I increase the value of H, you can see there is a more drop in the temperature at the end, but the temperature distribution is of course linear, and this temperature drop it cannot go beyond it below 30 degrees Celsius, because when the temperature at the extreme end reaches to 30 degrees Celsius, there is no heat transfer between the tip and the environment, so temperature can fall up to 30 degrees Celsius only if my T environment is 30 degrees Celsius. Similarly, we have gone through the solution of the solution to two-dimensional problems, a simple problem wherein TB1, TB2, TB3, TB4, these are the boundary conditions known to me. If I have a temperatures known to me, like let's say TB1 is 100, 200, 300 and 400 degrees Celsius, the solution can be represented in terms of steady state temperature line contours. You can see if this is the problem, the best validity to such kind of problem is that my temperature at the center should be the average of all the four temperatures. You can see the 250 degrees Celsius line goes through the center. Or let's say if I have 200 degrees Celsius line, it hits the only line which hits the bottom is 200 degrees Celsius line, because my bottom is at a 200 degrees Celsius temperature. All other lines are going away from the 200 degrees Celsius line. Similarly, 300 degrees Celsius line hits here, the right boundary only, because my right boundary is at a temperature of 300 degrees. So essentially what I want to communicate through this problem is that finite volume methodology works well to obtain the solution. We can represent the solution in the flooded form also. These are the steady state temperature flooded contours, wherein each color of a temperature band represent some or the other temperature. Again, the temperature at the center is around 250 degrees Celsius, which is essentially a validation of the finite volume method. This is called essentially a post-processing in case of computational fluid dynamics. Once you obtain the solution, you can look at the data diagrammatically, because diagrammatic representation gives you better understanding instead of only looking at the number. If you look at the numbers in terms of a temperature distribution, you are not able to understand anything. But this temperature data is of course useful to determine the engineering parameters which are of importance to us. For example, in this case, the important engineering parameters is if I am able to understand how much heat transfer is occurring across this space, how much heat transfer is occurring across other faces, that is important to us. And that can be calculated once I know this temperature distribution. For example, if I want to calculate the local heat transfer rate, local and total rate of heat transfer from bottom and top wall. For example, from bottom wall, if I want to do that, I know the temperature at all the bottom points is 200 degrees Celsius. I know the now from the temperature distribution, I know the temperatures at the inner cell centers. With this, we have calculated, right? If I take the temperature, this temperature difference and divide it by the distance between two cell centers at the bottom, then what I obtain is a temperature gradient. That temperature gradient, if I multiply by minus K, I can find, and if I multiply it by the corresponding area, let's say, for example, here, I know the temperature here now because I have found out that I know the temperature here from the boundary condition. From this, I can find out the temperature gradient. This temperature gradient is prevailing over these cells, this much of area. So minus K into this temperature gradient into area, that gives me local heat transfer at this point, local heat transfer rate. So thus I can keep on calculating local heat transfer rate. So that's what is done here. Minus QQI1 is equal to minus K TI2 minus TI1 divided by delta Y by 2. This is temperature gradient. This is heat flux. If I want to calculate total heat transfer across each of the cell, QI1, that's total heat transfer, it is given analytically like this. Integral 0 to L QI1, which is known to us, into dx. But numerically, I can calculate it like this. Summation over I is equal to 2 to I max minus 1 QI1 into delta x. My dx is delta x. So this is what is shown here. We have calculated and we have actually represented the local heat transfer rate. I can calculate the local heat transfer rate, then I can sum it up and can calculate the total heat transfer rate once I know the temperature distribution. That's what I'm trying to communicate to you. And this has been done for bottom and top wall. So that's something about a steady state. So for other boundary conditions also, we have carried out the simulations and I'm sharing those results with you. Again, these are some of the important results. I'm not going to take you through the flow problem, but let me take you through the next. I'm left with 5 minutes now, but maybe I will extend it for another 5. So no, sir, is it comfortable if I extend it for 5 minutes, for 5 additional minutes?
Yes, sir. No problem, because at 11, they are still preparing for their inaugural function. So no problem, sir.
Okay. So now what we have done so far, we have looked at the steady state problem, but let us now look at the unsteady state problem. If it is the unsteady state problem, I have the governing equations like this, Cp into del by del t of rho t into k grad square k grad square t plus q bar. Q bar is a heat generation. This equation all of you know. This equation we will apply to the problem like this. Again, I am not going to take you through the grid generation now. We will be considering us again same problem, but now we will be using unsteady state equation to obtain the solution. Maybe I have a square plate which is subjected to different boundary condition. The square plate is considered as a heat transfer domain. We can carry out the grid generation and same procedure we can go ahead with. In this case now, the only thing is that we have an additional term which is unsteady term which has to be discretized, and we have a heat generation also that is also required to be discretized. How do we discretize unsteady term? Let's say this is the exact representation of the unsteady term. It is Cp into integral over delta Vp. So what we consider a small control volume, and to that control volume we apply the unsteady term, and it is represented like this. In Cp into integral over delta Vp, del by del t of rho t dv. dv is operator. But we assume, see, there are infinite number of points within a control volume, and each point may have a different value of del by del t. We take into consideration its mean, and we assume that mean is constant, and we take it out of the integral sign. So what is left inside the integral sign is dv, and its integral of dv is delta Vp. So Cp into del by del t of rho t mean, we further assume that this mean value is also equal to value at p. So this mean is replaced in terms of del by del t of rho t p. So Cp into del by del t of rho t p into delta Vp is the next approximation. We further replace this unsteady term as Tpn plus 1 minus Tpn upon delta t. N represent the time instant. So n plus 1 and n, these are two consecutive time instances which are delta t duration apart. Delta t is a time duration between two time instances which are represented by n and n plus 1. So this is my discrete representation of unsteady term. You see, this equation is no more a differential or integral equation now. This term is no more a differential or integral term. This is an algebraic term, right? We have already seen the discrete representation of the diffusion term in the equation. So this is my diffusion term now. Only thing is that in the earlier case, k was not there. Now the k is there. But we assume that thermal conductivity is constant, and we have already written it out of the different derivative sign, or we can take it out of the integral sign also. This is integral representation of my diffusion term. K is taken out of the integral sign. Volumetric integral is converted into surface integral as we did it earlier. The surface integral is then split into east, west, north, south, and summed up here. Then we consider the gradient. This gradient we consider as a constant for a particular phase. We take it out of the integral sign. What is left inside the integral sign is DSF, and then integral of DSF is delta SF. What is outside the integral sign is k into dt by dn. Now this k into dt by dx is nothing, dn is nothing but it's a flux, heat transfer flux because of diffusion or conduction. So I am just calling it as FD, diffusion flux. So summation over east, west, north, south faces of a diffusion flux. Now this is flux of, when I'm saying FD, FT, what I mean to say is diffusion flux across a face and diffusion of heat. T represents the heat. Because this is a diffusion of heat, I am representing it as FD, FT into delta SF. So this is my, when I sum it up for all the faces, this gives me a total diffusion. The total diffusion occurring across east, west, north, south faces, which can be written as DPT. DPT is nothing but the, in the discretized form, diffusion. This is nothing but a diffusion flux. FD is a diffusion flux, but DPT is a total flux occurring across all the faces of a cell represented by P. And diffusion is of a heat, because of which I'm using suffix T here. DPX, it is summation over east, west, north, south faces, FD, FT, delta SF, which can also be replaced as K into TE minus TP upon del XC. Delta XC into delta SC. This we have already done. So FD, FT, we are replacing using this, this temperature gradient into K. And of course, all the temperature gradients are multiplied with, by the corresponding areas. So this is my total diffusion occurring across all the faces of a control volume. Once I know this total diffusion, I can also think of discretizing the heat generation term. The exact representation of heat generation is integral over delta Vp del Q bar into dV is equal to Q bar. We assume that this Q bar is constant for a particular control volume, and we assume that mean value is constant. We take it out of the integral sign. What is left inside the integral sign is dV. Its integral is delta Vp. Then we assume that the mean value is also equal to value at P. So this is the approximate representation of my source term, which is a heat generation term in this case. Now I can write down all the equations are combined together. The first, this is my unsteady term, this is DPT, and this is SPT. The same thing is diagrammatically represented here. TP at n plus 1 level minus changes to TP at n plus 1 level. That's my unsteady phenomena. Then DPT is given as the summation of all these four minus k dt by dx w at west space into delta y minus k dt by dx, sorry, dt by dy, this has to be dt by dy at south face into delta x. Here it is minus, here it is k, the minus minus becomes positive, so this has become k into dt by dx at east face into delta y. This is again, minus minus has become positive, k into dt by dy. There is, this has to be dy at north face into delta x. So this is This is a physical representation of my DPT, that is total diffusion occurring across all the faces. And here is a physical representation of diagrammatic representation of a heat generation. So I know this is now my finite volume equation. This is a discrete form of equation now. There is no differential or integral terms. And now this equation has to be solved. How do we solve this equation? There are two different methods available to solve this equation. If we write down DPT at nth level and SPT at nth level, then the only unknown, nth level is nothing but the level which is known to us from the initial condition. From initial conditions and boundary conditions, we can calculate DPT at all the cell centers. And then we can employ that to a particular cell center and calculate the new value of TP at n plus 1 level. This is new time instant. Do remember, in the earlier case, when we studied steady state solution, it was simply the initial case, but now we are considering initial condition. We need to give initial conditions and boundary conditions. And delta T is a time duration between two time instances. So now this new value can be found out by considering DPT at all the endpoints. So DPT like this, this can be calculated if I know the initial conditions for all the cell centers, all the cells. And I can apply this equation now, finite volume equation, to all the cells and calculate TP at n plus 1 level for all the cells. When we do use like this, when we write down this DPT at nth level, what we get is one equation and one unknown kind of condition. So I can scroll through all the cell centers and can calculate the temperatures at all the points at new time instance. But when we adopt such kind of a methodology, there is a stability criteria and which needs to be satisfied, otherwise my solution diverges. And the stability criteria is alpha delta t 1 by delta x square plus delta y square should be smaller than or equal to half. The proof to this particular stability criteria is available in the regular text. You can refer to any of the textbooks on the computational fluid dynamics and the proof is available. So such a method is called explicit method. There is another method available which is implicit in nature, which does not require any stability criteria, and that method is we assume DPT also at n plus 1 level. When we do that, in one equation there are more than one unknown. There are more number of unknowns. But if I write down such kind of equations for all the cell centers like this, if I write down equations for all the cell centers, for example, in this case, we will get 25 equations and we will have 25 unknowns, because unknowns will be in each equation. There will be more than one unknown, but some of the unknowns will be repeating in different equations, and total it is not possible to have more than 25 unknowns. So 25 unknowns and 25 equations, we can solve those equations simultaneously and we can obtain the solution. And such a method of obtaining the solution is called implicit method. So that's the implicit way. There are certain advantages and disadvantages of implicit and explicit method, which we will talk about. But here I'm just showing you the computational stencil for explicit and implicit method. So in an explicit method, if I want to find out the temperature at next time level, I need the information about all the cell centers from the previous time instance. However, in case of an implicit method, if I want to find out the temperature here, I also need to express the information of the cell centers at the same level, and the only information required from the previous level is at this point. So this is implicit and explicit method. There are certain advantages and disadvantages of implicit and explicit method, which you can go through quickly. The explicit method is relatively simple to set up and program. It has a disadvantage that it results in longer computer times to make the calculation over a given interval of time, because you need to keep the delta value as small as possible so that my solution does not converge, does not diverge. In implicit method, there is a computational, the considerable fewer time steps to make the calculation over the given interval of time. However, computer time per time step is much larger because we need to solve the equation simultaneously. For transient problems, we normally, if the problems are intrinsically transient in nature, it is suggested to make use of an explicit method, because we want to understand the transitions, anyway, we need to keep delta t small. And if we are keeping delta t small, then it is better to make use of an explicit method. So that's something about. We can write down the solution algorithm in the same fashion. Only thing is that in the earlier case, there was initial guess. Here now we have initial value. In the earlier case, there was no delta t. Here we have a delta t. We can calculate that delta t using the stability criteria which we have just now seen. This algorithm is now given to you, which is useful for writing a solution using explicit methodology. Best is again almost say similar. We set all the non-Dirichlet boundary condition, Dirichlet boundary condition, then set t old ij is equal to tij, and then we calculate dij, that is total diffusion across all the faces of all the control volumes, and we calculate tij at n plus 1 level. This is the algorithm. Then we calculate RMS value as we did in the earlier case also. And if this RMS value is less than epsilon, we assume that the solution is reached, and then we can print the temperature. Of course, the steady state, if the process is steady state in intrinsically steady state in nature, then only this is possible. Else, your solution will keep, you can carry on solution till the time which you want. Till the time at which you want the solution. You can print the solution at every interval of time or few interval of time or whatever, at whatever instances you want the solution. You can print that solution and you can look at the solution graphically. For example, here I'm just sharing with you the solution of one-dimensional unsteady state heat conduction. I have just captured the solution at the in-between solution, and I'm just sharing that solution with you. This is not the steady state solution. It's a transient solution at a particular instant which has been captured and shared with you. Of course, the steady state solution for such kind of problem is not to, it's a straight line. If I keep, because this problem is intrinsically steady state in nature, it may reach to straight line. Similarly, here I'm sharing with you a solution for a simple problem wherein TB1, TB2, TB3, TB4 are known to you as 100, 200, 300 degrees Celsius. So this solution is not the steady state solution. Let me repeat, we have captured the temperature distribution in between and have plotted the solution for temperature contours. Such kind of temperature contours can be plotted for various time instances, which help you to understand the transitions which are occurring in the temperature. So thus I come to this is the flooded steady state solution. Thus I come to the conclusion of or the end of the conduction problem, pure conduction problem. In the next session, I will deal with the pure convection problem and convection conduction problem. And then in the last session, I will deal with the solution of entire Navier-Stokes equation. If you have any questions, I know I have gone a little bit fast because I assume that some of the faculty members are also acquainted with the heat transfer and fluid mechanics, so they are able to cope up with. With that hope, I am going ahead with a little bit fast because I need to cover entire basics in one day. This is just a kind of a rebrushing for all of you, which will be helpful to you. If you have any kind of question, please go ahead. Sonone, sir?
Yes, sir. I think we can take a question in the afternoon session because they have a complete glance of the basics.
So especially for conduction. Conduction we did only. Of course, not so, convection.
From my point of view, if they have any questions, they can just write down right now within their notes. And in the afternoon, we can discuss briefly. That will be great.
I hope I'm going in a proper distinct direction. The everything is clear, and the voice and everything is clear.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you very much, sir, for session. Now we'll be meeting at 1:30 sharp after lunch. So right now there is a inauguration program is going on from 11 to 12. So 12 to 12:30 we have a lunch break. So participant can join from 1:15 onwards. Make sure you will join by 1:30. So Dr. Shevadkar will start sharp at 1:30. So that we can have sufficient time for question answering session at the end.
Shevadkar, thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Shall I leave?
Yes, sir. So I'm ending this session. All participants are requested to join that YouTube channel for a common inauguration program. They are streaming it live. Okay. Thank you very much. I have also shared all these things on the WhatsApp group. So you can have there. Thank you.